Broadcasting all over the world at urbanbroadcastmedia.com. Delivering love and inspiration
24/7.
This is UBM Praise. The following show is paid programming and does not necessarily express the views and opinions of Urban Broadcast Media and its subsidiaries.
Thank you for listening to UBM Praise.
A young man that you all know is Joe the Policeman from the What's Going Down episode of That's My Mama. I want you to put your hands together and welcome him to the stage. Big round of applause.
Sir Walter Jones.
Who is it?
Sir Walter Jones.
What's his name?
Sir Walter Jones.
Whose show is this?
Sir Walter Jones.
Who is it?
Sir Walter Jones.
Say it again.
Sir Walter Jones.
Who are you with?
Sir Walter Jones.
One more game.
Sir Walter Jones.
The Sir Walter Jones Show, co-host Alvin Carter. We are a Christian talk show in where we tackle all the hot topics in a believer's walk.
Sir Walter Jones.
Who is it?
Sir Walter Jones.
What's his name?
Sir Walter Jones.
Whose show is this?
Sir Walter Jones.
Who is it?
Sir Walter
Ladies,
Jones.
Say it again.
It's Tuesday. Pink Perspectives. On the Sir Walter Jones
Tuesday,
Show,
Tuesday,
right here on UBM Praise.
Hello, 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 everybody out there in Radio Land. This is Sir Walter. I'm the host of the Sir Walter Jones Show, and I am excited. This is Tuesday. It is Pink Perspectives. Pink Perspective. It is our show on women, about women, for women. Around women, and usually what we do is we gather all the women around America and see what they can do to help us men out. They either call in or they come in, one of the two, and they go at it. We've been having some very, very interesting shows on Tuesdays with the women because, you know, they can talk. So, which segues away into who's laughing in the background. What we had, for those of you who listened into the show yesterday on racism in America, I want to thank you. It was a very hot discussion, but it was very civil. Mm-hmm. We had men on this. It was men's. It's called Men Chronicles on Mondays, and the men talked about some very serious things. And part two will be this coming Monday. If you're listening to this show weeks ahead of time, later on in the year, or you're in 2015 right now, then just go on Spreaker, which where you are all listening to right now, if this is 2015, and
yes!
Yeah, and go up there and look at the content and see the show that says racism in America. Also, part two is Black on Black Crime, which is the following Monday. But today, although when you were listening yesterday, I mentioned we were going to talk about domestic violence. We were going to talk about domestic violence today, but we're going to have to postpone that because one of the young ladies, Davinia, who's usually here on Tuesdays, is got the bug. She's been bit by her school kids. Everybody's catching some type of a bug and worm and virus at the school.
Oh no!
So she was gracious enough not to come in. I told her the life that she may save is mine. So I told her stay home.
That's right. Then
Crystal Waters, who has a show here on Saturdays at 1 o'clock Central. In between gigs and jobs and what have you, and they called her today, told her to come in now, and so I said, praise God, that's the best cancellation I've ever had. Girl, make it rain, get that money, boo boo. She still may, you know, if she gets out on time, she says she still may stop by. Crystal Waters, I geared my show off of her topic last Saturday about domestic violence. But what I decided to do, all because I am the host of this show, so I can do what I want to, I decided to change the subject matter. Tomorrow, which is Wednesday, we have a new family joining the UBM Praise family, and that is the Mind, Body, and Soul with Annette Harris. Will be launching her new show. It's not new to America. It's just new to the Urban Broadcast Media family. And so we are excited to have Anand Harris. How are you?
Wonderful. How are you?
Yeah, that was for you.
Wow, thanks,
dude. That was for you. Yeah, even I don't get that on my show.
Yay.
For me. You know, you get special treatment. Yeah, Anand Harris' show was on another station in town. And the station have made different arrangements and plans for their property over there. And so she decided no longer to air over there. And she was looking for a place where she could be free and air and be a part of a family who act like a family.
That's right.
Yeah.
That's good. And good description.
Yeah. And, I think you came here for our appreciation party.
Yes, client appreciation.
Yeah, and you saw all of the personalities, and you were affected by that.
Yes, very much so.
It was
very exciting to see.
Yeah. And so you talked to the powers that be, and bam, there you are.
Here I am.
Tomorrow, 12 o'clock noon.
Yes.
Yourself and who else?
Myself, and I have two co-hosts, Sharon Ware. Well, she'll be known as SDW.
All right.
And Marlo Cribbs.
Okay.
Marlo Cribbs, he was my co-host at the previous radio station.
I see.
So he's coming over here to join me here.
So the top 10 is coming over.
Yes.
Okay.
Yes.
All right. Well, you people out there who don't know what the top 10 is,
stay tuned.
Y'all about to find out what that is on tomorrow. So
stay tuned.
Welcome to the family.
Thank you so much. I appreciate that. I'm excited.
Yeah. You know, just know that they'll take good care of you.
Yes, I believe that.
Lisa Frizzle, who is the executive producer, executive assistant. I don't know. You know, there's so many names. She's just an executive. she takes care of the Sir Walter Jones Show needs, and she really knows what she's doing. And she was able to, you know, get you on board. And
yes.
Hopefully we could have a long relationship with this this family.
Yes.
Okay. Now, that D.
Never know what to expect.
You never know what D is going to do. The premise of your show, set us up here. What's going on?
The purpose of Mind, Body, and Soul is actually to simply bring in the area of psychology, combine it with our biblical knowledge. In times past and how we've come along, we really have not related psychology anywhere near the Bible, God, the church, or anything. It was always taboo. Hmm. I actually was blessed to study psychology and to attain my my degree from Trinity Christian College.
Where's that?
In Palos Heights, Illinois.
Okay.
And it was a very wonderful experience that I had at that college and on that campus. And one thing that I took away that stuck with me while I was taking classes was that every subject that was studied, everything was related back to God. And it was just joined. It was linked. So it didn't matter whether it was psychology, sociology, math, you know, all the subjects, everything just, they had you to relate it back. You know, it's a Christian college. And I took that away when I left there, and I was like, that's good to relate that, because my belief, you know, in Christ is strong, and that's what carries me, that's what guides me. So what better way than, you know, whatever else I'm studying or I'm interested in to connect that. So that is the setup of Mind, Body, and Soul. That the whole concept is to look at different areas, different topics that we're faced with, you know, on a daily basis, different things we're faced with, especially in the church. Mm-hmm. We're faced with so much, and unfortunately, we don't know how to handle it. Mm-hmm. We don't know how to handle it because a lot of times we don't address it. We're not aware. So I try to bring awareness to different things, whether it's mental illness and, you know, anything else that, you know, can relate to your day-to-day life experiences. I try to bring awareness to it, try to put a name on it, try to address it, try to find solutions. And that, again, is the whole setup of Mind, Body, and Soul.
you enter into college studying this.
Mm-hmm.
Okay. But why did you do that?
Why did I do that? I have always had a desire. I've always looked around at different individuals and I've always wondered why they do what they do. That's just how my mind works. Mm-hmm. If I see a child, you know, as they may say, acting out, I want to know exactly why they're acting out, not, you know, just because they couldn't get that candy. Is there something else that's going on there? And some people think, I may think too deep, but that's just how I am. A lot of times, eight times out of 10, I'm right. There is something deeper going on there.
Sure.
And so that's what prompted me to go into the studies of psychology and sociology as well. And so that's how I arrived there.
You think there's mental illness in the church?
Undoubtedly, yes. Resounding yes, there is. There is definitely mental illness in the church. And I'm sitting next to... No, I'm just kidding.
She's sitting next to Art Lewis, by the way, y'all. Yeah.
Okay, see, and I was about to go... That's all right. That's fine. That's well
fine. That's my guy. Yeah. Hey, Art.
She has discernment, though.
Yeah.
There's definitely mental illness in the church. But unfortunately, we don't recognize it to even address it.
Yeah. I'm going to read an article here, and you tell me you're familiar with it. Mm-hmm. This is an article, let's see here, WNG.org. Okay. World Real Matters or something like that.
Mm-hmm.
Rick Warren launches a mental health ministry.
Mm.
Lake Forest, California. If the sold out seats for Saddleback Church Mental Health Conference last Friday are any indication, Christians are aching for more and better mental health ministry in the church. A responsive, emotional crowd of more than 3,300 people filled Saddleback's worship center for the gathering on mental health and the church.
Mm-hmm.
A day-long event hosted by Saddleback, the Roman Catholic Diocese of Orange, and the National Alliance on Mental Illness, Orange County.
Okay.
The event marks the first initiative of Saddleback Church's new ministry for mental health issues, a mission Saddleback hopes other churches will replicate.
Mm-hmm.
Friday's conference featured a lineup of pastors, academic, and psychiatrists who spoke about the church's potential and necessary role in dealing with mental illness and disorders.
Mm.
According to Saddleback, about 600 of the attendees are struggling with mental illness, 600 of them. And an additional 6,000 people turned in for the event's live webcast, which will be archived and made available for public for free. The conference took place just 8 days before the 1-year anniversary of Saddleback pastor Rick Warren's son's death.
Okay.
Which you know about.
Yes.
Matthew Warren, he was 27, shot himself
mm-hmm.
in April 5, 2013.
Mm-hmm.
The youngest of the Warren's children. Matthew struggled with lifelong depression.
Yes.
During this opening remarks on Friday, Rick Warren said he too had experienced panic attacks
mm-hmm.
and depression.
Mm-hmm.
He later added, there are two types of people, those who need recovery and know it, and those who need recovery and don't.
Yeah.
Most of the conference discussions and speeches presented practical ways for churches to be mental health resource.
Okay.
And it goes on. The topics range from depression, suicide, eating disorders, which we don't think about.
Mm-hmm.
Eating disorders is one of them.
Mm-hmm.
The crisis management for church staff and church counseling. With cracking voices and great vulnerability, many speakers shared their testimonies of dealing with mental illness, either as a sufferer or as a loved one.
Mm-hmm.
The audience responded with gasps, sympathetic murmurs, and standing ovations.
Right.
Finally, something was done.
Yes.
And if anything, it brought awareness that mental illness exists in the church at large.
Exactly.
And okay. It's not just spirits.
Yeah, right, right.
Right.
Not just spirits.
Right.
So the problem, and it's funny that you brought that up, because now we've got to, now that we know that mental illness exists in the church, we still got to decipher whether it's a spirit or it's a neurological disorder.
Right.
And are they both intertwined? Because, you know,
yep.
The devil can use the physiological to attack, okay, or to oppress a man. But how much of it is all spirit and how much of it is, you know, is natural?
Right, right.
And who makes that determination?
Now, you know, it's something. I first want to say I am so excited. I wasn't even at that conference, but I'm excited that it happened. Mm-hmm. You know, here is an example of a man that's a pastor that decided, you know, I am going to try to do something about this situation. You know, his son was had dealt with depression and obviously, you know, took his own life, unfortunately. But the father didn't stop there. He didn't just, I know he grieved, but it obviously brought to his mind or let him know, you know, if my son was suffering from this, there are other people, you know, suffering from this. Let's try to do something about this. Now, there is a difference. Of course, we know that Pastor Rick Warren is not black. Okay.
Right.
But unfortunately, in our black churches, we do not address this. We do not even want to touch it.
Why?
What we will do, we will just label it as, oh, that she has a devil.
Right.
He has a devil. And, you know, now sometimes I guess they're addressing it is come to the altar. Let me pray for you.
Mm-hmm.
Now, let me take a step back and say, I am not against praying. Mm-hmm. I am not against, you know, casting the devil out.
Mm-hmm.
You know, I grew up in the church, so that's what I'm that's my background. But you have to know what kind of devil that you're dealing with.
Mm-hmm.
You can't just say, OK, come up here. I'm going to lay hands on you and just pray. What are you praying for? Are you praying for, you know, what spirit is it? What, mm-hmm. you know, what devil, quote unquote, devil is it? So
right.
you have to understand and know. And I think we have to go back you know, take into consideration know that we have to have people that are trained in these areas to understand and know these different mental illnesses. If I can say that, you have, you know, psychologists that are Christians. Mm-hmm. If you don't want to go outside, you know,
I was about to ask you that. Like, does this professional have to be church bound or church originated from the church? Because I'm like, this is, and when they do address this, they have a tendency to, well, you need to find someone that's, like, you know, indoctrinated into the blood, that's from the family of the church, and this, that, and other. And I was like, why is that? You don't ask if your doctor's a Christian,
right?
And you know, if you have to have open heart surgery, you want the best guy that has the best record and everything else for that neurological surgery. You want to have the best person. You're not asking what are their personal views about other matters, although you do have some.
That's a good point, Art. I actually, because you can get off into a lot of stuff with this subject on today.
Right.
But
you will tomorrow.
What'd you say?
You will tomorrow.
And I will tomorrow. You're right. those are very good points you brought up. I don't necessarily say that you have to have somebody that's in the church, but sometimes.
She said it, Art.
Sometimes you may have to.
Yeah, shock and awe.
You may have to say, okay, I know of a Christian mental health professional that I can refer you to. They may be able to accept that better. That person better.
Sure.
My whole thing, I just want you to get help. Right. And I want you to be able to get somebody in there that has this expertise and this knowledge, you know, that can help. So if you feel more comfortable that they're a Christian, okay, there are plenty of them out there, you know. And then, you know, I can also piggyback off of what you said, you know, our medical doctors, are they Christians, you know?
Your brakes go out on your car, do
right.
you stop
your
and
mechanic,
ask your mechanic
is he
a
Christian, you know?
Is he going
to
lay hands on the car and pray
right.
for it, or is he going to get up under the hood and start working on it?
Some of them do. No. No, but I don't think we need to get hung up on that. That's just me.
Sure. Well, Charletta Brown on Facebook says, all I like to say about the subject is leave the diagnosis to the certified professionals, even if you think God showed you someone has mental illness, mental issues. You know what? Yeah. As rarely as I disagree with her, I agree with her here.
Right.
I agree. I think, and I say this all the time, the pastors think that they can solve all of your problems, mm-hmm. and they can't because they can't solve their own problems.
No.
That's why many of them are committing suicide.
Thank you.
Because they can't.
You know what? A great leader is an individual that knows how to delegate.
Mm-hmm. Yes.
It's all the way, you see it in the military, you see it even in corporate. They don't necessarily know everything. They may know a little something about a lot of different things, mm-hmm. but they know how to see a situation, know whether or not they can handle it,
right,
or if it needs to go to somebody else, and then they delegate it off to someone else.
That's perfect. That's perfect. I totally agree with that.
That's good.
You have to know, and that's even in the corporate world, you know.
Yeah.
You have to know how to delegate. You can't just say, you know, I'm going to do everything. You're going to wear yourself out. You're who knows if your company will survive. You know, delegate, you know. Yep. And, you know, again, you know, going back to I do agree with Charles Etta, because you have to leave it to those who are, you know, the professionals to be able to diagnose, to be able to address these situations and help you find solutions. I had a pastor, as a matter of fact, maybe about a week or so ago, inbox me and ask me, did I know, first they asked me, did I have my own practice out yet? No, my practice has not started yet. It will eventually.
Yeah, it is. It's over here on UBM now.
But they asked me whether or not I knew of a healthcare professional, mm-hmm. that I could refer for them to, they had some in their congregation that they were trying to help and needed assistance. And I did refer a Christian mental health professional to them. So, I mean, I have no problem with, you know, doing either. I know of both, you know, those that are Christians and those that are not.
Nepotism. But,
what'd you say?
Nepotism.
No, that's not nepotism. No, I just said I know of both areas since I've been in this area of psychology. So, you know, it does. The whole point is we just want the people to get the help that they need. And it has to be addressed. You know, we can't keep saying that, this is not happening when it's happening right before your eyes, and you just keep sweeping things under the rug, and the rug gets bigger and bigger and bigger. And,
no, and you just ignore it and ignore it.
And nobody's being helped. Matter of fact, they're getting worse.
Sure.
Yeah.
Well, I'm going to kind of disagree with you guys on trying to find whether a secular God to help me or a Christian God to help me.
Okay.
Yeah. You know, that's, because if we all sing, hold hands and sing Kumbaya, this 2 hours going to turn to five.
I don't know if people keep singing the way Alvin does.
So my question is, why can't we find a Christian doctor? Why not? Why don't Christians go out there? Number one, why don't Christians raise up their own doctors, mm-hmm. and have their own medical clinics and what have you? Because, well, you look at the Catholics and the Jews, mm-hmm. they have their own in the medical field.
Yeah.
They call St. Jude, well, and St. this and all these hospitals.
Of course.
That's them. Right. Okay.
Yep,
and
that's
the Jews,
right.
have, okay, that's them. But we who are Protestant, why can't we raise up our own clinic?
Because we have too many divisions doctors. Of Protestants.
Okay. Yeah.
You got the, well, CME, yeah. the mm-hmm. ABCs, and XYZs.
Yeah. Yeah.
And everybody's telling each other that you're going to hell because you're not over here.
Okay.
We're under doctor.
Right. Okay.
Now, don't get me wrong. I'm not saying I'm a Christian. So, of course, you know, I would advocate that.
Yeah.
But I want, again, the only reason why I said it does, to me, it really doesn't matter, because you may have somebody on the other side of the fence. You may have a Christian and say, I don't want a Christian mental health professional.
Yeah, to each his own. I understand
right.
that.
So I'm just saying, you know, that it doesn't, it shouldn't,
but
we shouldn't, like, really just only push Christian.
No, I hear what you're saying.
Mm-hmm.
Okay. But when is the time? When will we start having that a place where we all can say, this is ours, we're going to start supporting ours.
Mm-hmm.
Once okay. we get to the point where we can get the mindset, like we both have a Facebook friend,
mm-hmm.
that constantly talk about all these different faiths. And no matter how many times I say it's not different faith, it's a different denomination, because
mm-hmm.
it is the same right. faith.
One faith, one Lord, one baptism.
Right. I say one God, one Son of God, one redemption. That's the core of it. All this other stuff gets divided, but that does not mean it's a different faith. But no matter how many times this is said, this individual will keep coming back with all these different faiths.
All these things and so, more.
So until we can do away with that thing and see where we are connected and where we are similar, we will constantly be divided and no one will unify.
Okay. Okay. And I agree.
I do. There's a place that we
There's a place that we have to get to. All right. Mm-hmm.
Okay. That's the word I was looking for.
Sure. There's a place we have to get to.
So you want
to
know when we're going to get to that place?
Okay. We got to get to that place soon. All right. Now.
And I know where a map is.
Yeah. Okay.
It's called the Bible.
When it comes to the mind and psychotherapy, mm-hmm. I will not give that over to someone that's not Christian or doesn't have to believe. I won't.
Right.
You know why? Because a man could fix my fingers. Mm-hmm. He could fix my toes and all this stuff. Mm-hmm. Okay. That's fine. What his faith is may not be as detrimental to me, but when it comes to my mind,
right,
that is the most important thing that I have. If I lose that, I lose everything, mm-hmm. including my body and my soul.
Mm-hmm.
Okay, so I can't give that to him, the unbeliever. My mind, I can't.
Right,
because that's why I'm having the problems I'm having now, because I was influenced by the world.
True.
Yeah. True. So I won't give him that. Now, I was reading something about that. It's very, very interesting. And we can go into details after the break on this.
Mm-hmm.
We're going to talk about psychotherapy. I agree with this article. It says, what are the roles of psychotherapy? Okay. There is no role for secular psychotherapy. It says no role for secular. Mental health does not exist for the unbeliever.
Mm.
And I'll go into details on why it says. And then our will disagree. And then,
we
And so, and then we'll go with that. Yeah. If you just tuned in, mm-hmm. this is the Sir Walter Jones Show. We have the great Annette Harris on the show, who is launching her Mind, Body, and Soul show tomorrow on UBM Praise at 12 o'clock noon. You do want to stay tuned every Wednesday for that show, because many of you are dealing with mental health issues in your family if you're not one yourself. All right? So people, you hear mental illness, you think straight crazy.
Yes.
That's not the case all the time.
It's not.
Y'all stop doing that.
Yes, stop labeling.
Okay? Stop labeling that. That's not always true. All right, and we'll go into details with that as well after this break. All right. Okay, y'all. This is UBM Praise, the Sir Walter Jones Show.
Log on to UrbanBroadcastMedia.com and check out the many services Urban Broadcast Media provides. Whether it's social media, video production, radio broadcasting, or audio recording, we got you covered. The following show is paid programming and does not necessarily express the views and opinions of Urban Broadcast Media and its subsidiaries.
Thank you for listening to UBM Praise.
Joy comes in the morning.
Joy comes in the morning.
Know that God is nigh.
Know that God is nigh.
Don't try to fight the battle yourself, but stand still.
Stand still and
look up. God is going to show up. He's standing right by.
He is standing by.
We want to say that one more time for somebody who may be discouraged. Don't be discouraged.
Don't be discouraged.
Woo! Because joy is on the way. Weeping may endure for a night, but joy comes in the morning. Know that God is nigh. That God is going to show up.
God is going to show up.
He is standing right by.
He is standing by.
For those of you who may not know it, there's healing.
There's healing for.
for your pain. From the rain. Lord, send the healing. Lord, send it for this one thing we know. One more time, that there's healing for your sorrow.
There's healing for your sorrow.
Healing for your pain.
Healing for your pain.
Healing
for your spirit.
There's shelter from. Somebody's been hurt tonight.
Heal all
who specializes in healing.
Hi, ho, and welcome
and
back.
And now, our feature presentation.
Ladies, it's Tuesday. Pink Perspectives on the Sir Walter Jones Show. Right here on UBM Praise.
Do 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 do.
Come on, Art. You're supposed to be rapping.
Oh, I don't do rap.
You don't do rap. Oh, see, now if Alvin Carter was here, he'd be spitting. Right, he'd be spitting the rhymes.
Jerry, he'd be spitting all over the mic. Anyway.
No, you did not.
You know what? You're right.
That's the Tasmanian
Devil.
That's
nowhere near as funny without him being right over there.
Give a shout out to Walter Jr., my son, who created that wonderful beat. That's why I look forward to Tuesday, just to hear that. Yeah. All right. We're talking about psychiatry. We're talking about mental illness. Mm-hmm. Psychiatry.
Psychology.
Okay.
There's a difference.
Now, let's go into the historics and definitions. You know, I'm all about definitions on my show. Mm-hmm. Me and Apostle David Rogers. He don't play when he come on. Hey, so okay, how do we define that, brother? How do we define that? I love it. Love that.
That's good. Make you think.
About my buddy, right, Apostle David.
Yes, yes. You may not like everything he say, but when he's done, you're gonna go home and read your dictionary.
Yes.
Okay.
Oh, I don't know. Walter. Yeah, Walter Light is rather.
Oh yeah, Walter Light. Huh?
Walter
yeah.
Light. Who's that?
Eric Hayes.
Eric Hayes, man.
Oh, y'all call him Walter
my
Light.
Jesus.
Yes, it is. Oh, Walter Light. Walter Light.
That's kind of cute.
Oh, Eric Jewel Hayes.
Yes. Yeah, that brother throw some words out there. And go
yes.
Like,
yeah, he will.
Yes, he's an amazing character.
I find it rather refreshing myself after being in the hood for so long.
Yeah. A psychiatrist once said that all emotions can be listed under these three labels. Okay, and I want two of you to define what these three labels are.
Go ahead.
Fear, anger, and sadness. Mm. Art, what is fear?
Fear is an uncontrollable desire to flee a situation.
Oh, okay. Annette? I'm not sure. Go.
Wow.
Okay, Annette? Fear.
Fear?
Mm.
Fear is the false evidence about reality.
Okay. False evidence about reality. You sure it's false?
That's more obscure.
Okay. All right.
It is.
Okay. Yeah, okay.
Okay.
Because you're fearing.
I'm sorry. What dispensation are we speaking of in fear?
Well, fear in general.
He just wanted to use a big word. Pay him no attention.
I'm not sure why that question came in.
Well,
okay.
In the Old Testament, fear meant to have a great sense of concern, whereas today, fear is most represented as being afraid.
Afraid. Well, in God, the whole fear thing is about respect, not to be afraid of.
Yeah, because
he said
reference.
To fear him, right?
Right.
Right.
Yeah, that's a different one.
Uh-huh. So, but this fear is to be afraid.
Mm-hmm.
It's the one I want you guys to define.
Okay, afraid.
Fear. So that's being afraid, anxiety, panic. Okay. Matthew 6:34,
mm-hmm.
verses 25-33 preceding it. So you guys can read that on your own. Okay. Mm-hmm. The second one is anger. All right. What's anger?
Rage.
Okay. Is it rage? I mean, is it always rage?
Yes.
Thank you.
Okay. All right. Annette, anger?
Anger. Mm-hmm. Oh, gosh. That's a good question.
The core
It is an emotional response to.
It's the core of men dominated emotion.
Mm-hmm. Okay. Okay.
What? You invited him?
No.
I got the text to prove it.
Well, I was saying that it's an emotional response to when you feel like you've been threatened.
Okay.
Psychologically.
Okay. All right. Frustration, resentment, rage. Okay. All right. That's Ephesians 4:26 said something to define to be angry, but what?
Sin not.
To sin not. Okay. Sadness. All right. Sadness. What is that?
I really don't know.
Okay. All right. At least he's honest. Annette?
I'm going to pray for you.
D got some new toys, yeah. Sadness.
It is an emotional feeling or emotional pain that you...
In the mic.
That you... Oh, I'm sorry. I'm not in the mic?
You got headphones on and you can't tell.
You know, I think I'm turned down low because it was so loud.
Oh, your headphones turned down low.
Yeah,
okay.
So I thought I was okay.
Well, don't turn us all up. No. Which one is yours? Right there? Which
I
one?
I think I'm number 3.
Oh, okay. Right there?
Yes.
Is that better?
All right. Yeah, but it's still kind of loud.
Still kind of loud?
Jeez. We'll deal with it. It's okay.
All right.
Okay. I was saying it is an emotional pain that people experience when they have a loss, you know, or they're in despair or they feel hopeless.
Emotions experienced when not in a state of well-being.
Okay. All right.
Okay.
All right. So sadness, that's depression, it's grief, mm-hmm. it's sorrow. 2 Corinthians 4:16 actually has a wonderful way of, you could almost end the show on that one, where it says, "For which cause we faint not, but though our outward man perish, mm-hmm. yet the inward man is renewed day by day. For our light afflictions, which is but for a moment, worketh for us as far more exceeding an eternal weight
of glory.
Of glory. While we look not at the things which are seen, but at the things which are not seen. For the things which are seen are temporal, but the things which are not seen are eternal." This is 2 Corinthians chapter 4 and 16 goes on. It's just talking about the motivation of external perspectives and what have you that's going mm-hmm. on, external. I think the person who's dealing with these aspects of fear, sadness, and anger can be encouraged by the word, okay? Mm-hmm. But the word of God doesn't always give you a practical things to do other than focusing on the Lord, okay?
Mm-hmm.
It is a book that we can lean on our spiritual aspect, but naturally we still need the help of man to get us through some things. God equips men to help us in information and what have you. Okay. But now we have to find out which man do we go to for this. My pastor, who I respect so dearly, mm-hmm. When I was having marital problems, I went to, he found out we were having marital problems and he called me and he says, "Here is a phone number to a Christian
counselor.
Mm-hmm. He's a psychologist."
Mm-hmm.
Okay. And I was floored that my own pastor was giving me someone else.
Right.
All right.
Now, in that instance where you say you got a counselor of a Christian nature, in that I can agree with you wholeheartedly about what you said earlier.
Okay.
You need to have a Christian counselor. I mean, you need for your psyche and things of this type of nature.
Mm-hmm.
In the aspects of morality, I definitely would need to have a counselor that was of a Christian type faith.
Absolutely.
Then that way he can relate to what it is.
Yes.
And where it is I'm coming from.
That's good. And that was my point earlier. Good. And that's a good way of putting it. And you're true. It's true that a doctor who's trying to heal my hand, I don't need to know if he's Baptist, Presbyterian, Lutheran, or, you know, okay, just heal my hand, you know, mm-hmm. whether you're going to do surgery or put a Band-Aid on it and send me on my way. But when it comes to my mind, you may be trying to tell me to do something immoral to fix my mind. And that could be a problem.
Right.
So my pastor sent me to someone that he felt who could help me.
Right.
All right. Now, he didn't send me to his other pastor friend.
Okay.
All right. He sent me to a guy who got down. I went downtown.
Mm-hmm.
He had papers on his wall.
So he had degrees.
Okay. And I was paying him $100 an hour. And his fee was $150 an hour. So he gave me a discount. All right. And it was 1 hour session. Okay. And I had to come back and do another hour, and I had to come back. So I'm paying money for this. All right. Now my pastor, he's free. All right. But my pastor realized I can only take you so far. All right.
Sure.
All right. They may call me doctor, but I'm not a doctor in this. Okay.
Yeah, yeah.
Just like just because the man got a lawyer behind his name don't mean he's going to be a lawyer for you, because you need legal help. He's not a trial lawyer.
Right.
He may be litigation guy.
Or a real estate
He may
lawyer.
Be a real estate. You know what I'm saying?
Right.
And people who are in the music business, they, you know, when they need lawyers to take care of certain things, but they have to get an entertainment lawyer. Mm-hmm. Okay? Or you're going to be screwed because you found Brother Bob, who knows Eldridge, who's a cab driver, who's a lawyer on the side.
That's
and he's sitting at the table trying to make a deal with
like
you and Word Records, you know, and that's he's the wrong lawyer.
Yeah.
So it says that there's this, the emotions are in these three: fear, anger, and sadness. Now let's talk about the whole Jesus being a human.
Mm-hmm.
Okay.
Oh yes.
Yeah. Now Jesus.
Jesus.
Uh-huh. Jesus. Mm-hmm. Isaiah 53 that we know so well. 53:3. Okay.
Uh-huh.
And we know who we come from. Unto us a child is born, a son is given. The government shall be upon his shoulder. On and on and on. We know who he is. But he experienced compassion.
Mm-hmm.
For the need of the people, for the leper, okay, the blind man, the starving crowd, he had compassion. Y'all agree?
Yes.
Okay. Number two, he had anger
because
he cursed the fig tree.
Yep.
He whipped the money changers in the temple. He talked about those Pharisees, called them a nation of vipers, and said that you are the you of your father the devil. Okay. So he had anger.
Yep.
Number three, he had grief.
Yes.
When he rode on a donkey, when Lazarus died, I think he cried.
When he said, all I asked you boys to do was just stay up with me and y'all went to sleep. What the?
Mm-hmm. Yep. When he looked upon Jerusalem in Luke 19:41, he cried.
Mm-hmm.
Okay. When he revealed that that a disciple would betray him. Okay. In the Garden of Gethsemane, he says, I am grieved upon up and he said, even unto death.
Yes.
Matthew 26:38. That's anguish. They call it.
Mm-hmm.
He had, matter of fact, he had a rare medical condition called hematidrosis.
Yes. He
and
did.
That's where he sweat blood.
Mm-hmm.
Okay. That's a disease.
Yes, it is.
Because he grieved. All right. Now, this is mental illness we're talking about. And when we mentioned mental illness as being somebody crazy.
Right.
But we don't think about these temporary
exactly.
situations in the mentality.
He need to be on my show, huh?
Come on now. He experienced joy when the 70 disciples came back. Remember?
Right.
And then they began to talk to him about the witnessing, and he was excited.
Mm-hmm.
Christ was excited that people were coming to the Lord. He experienced love. He loved Martha.
Yes.
And her sister.
Mm-hmm.
And Lazarus.
Mm-hmm.
And Peter.
Mm-hmm.
Okay. And I believe in my heart of heart that he also had to deal with sexual temptation.
Oh, yes.
Because he was
in all points tempted.
There you go.
Like as we are, yet without sin.
And we always say, you know, I hear my father say a lot that the largest temptation Christ ever received sexually, it was when the woman who washed his feet and then she began to dry his feet with her hair.
Yes, Lord.
If that silk don't do nothing for a man's
I don't know, man. After walking around in them sandals and stuff, them feet kind of, you know.
Yeah, but you weren't back in them days.
That was them. They were some rough tootsies, man. You know,
okay.
Man. You could probably like rub your feet together, start a fire.
Yeah, yeah. That's because y'all got all this new stuff today.
Right.
But back then, anything could set you off sexually. you out there with all them animals. So Jeremiah, he slipped into depression.
Mm.
Jeremiah chapter 15:10.
Wait, excuse me. Can I ask you something?
Yes.
Did you say anything about Jesus experiencing depression?
I just mentioned a lot of these things. I think part of his grief in the
garden.
Yeah, that was straight depression.
That was definitely depression.
Was
I wanted you to bring. That's why I asked that. I wanted that to be brought
well,
up.
Well, I said
I firmly believe he experienced it.
Yeah, when I said grief, that's depression. Really, he was grieved to the point where he began to reverse. And he was like, you know what? Take this from me. I can't do this.
Yes.
Now that was the human part of Christ.
Exactly.
You know, because we say, well, he's 50% man, 50% God. How can you be 50% man?
Because, see, that was the left side.
That was the left side?
Right. Then on the right side.
See, Art knows.
I think he was ambidextrous, really.
Ambidextrous. Okay. All right. So Jeremiah went into depression. He said he felt fear, anger, unforgiveness.
Mm-hmm.
All right. Job. Well, what did he suffer?
Everything.
Job went into that dispassionate aspect of depression.
Mm-hmm.
Yeah, whatever.
Mm-hmm.
Yeah,
sure.
Right.
Sure.
Job, you can say that.
The building fell down. Yeah, whatever.
Yeah, whatever.
Your wife is Yeah, yeah, she is.
Jonah slipped into
a
belly.
Yeah, he did. Yeah, belly, he was. He got spit out.
And he got rejected, man. That was the ultimate rejection, to be eaten up and then regurgitated.
Yeah, but then when he went and did what he was supposed to do.
Well, he sat up under the tree, okay, and he began to say, really?
Yeah.
You know, and he got all upset, and then God had to show him another lesson up under that little juniper tree, okay, and made it wither and messed up his shade and what have you. He
discovered gravity.
He wanted to do what Job's wife told him to do.
Don't
curse God.
Yeah, right.
The writer of a lot of the Psalms were depressed. If you just read some of the Psalms, it was depressing.
Mm-hmm.
You look at the whole book of Lamentations.
Mm-hmm.
Okay. Samson, he suffered with an addiction. Yes.
You didn't need no sound effect for that one.
Samson was a freak.
What? Okay.
Yeah, he was a freak.
Get out of here, man.
Was. Samson was a freak.
He was hugging the lion. He didn't mean to break the lion's.
Okay,
what?
He was hugging. All right.
He was.
Yeah, yeah.
I mean,
and he was addicted to that woman. He couldn't leave those women. Well, God told him.
Being addicted to a woman versus
the woman.
Women's.
Yeah, yeah. Okay.
Make you got to get strong, run off at the city gates, boy. Oh. Woo!
All right,
girl,
well.
You look so good, somebody ought to put you on a plate and sop you up with a biscuit.
That was Samson. That's what he said. And he had to go to a female haircut, a salon.
Specialist.
A female barber.
Yep. The writer of Ecclesiastes, he had cynical tunnel vision.
Mm.
Yes. Now
sound like some folks I know.
I know. Uh huh. Yeah. Elijah sunk into fear and depression as he ran from Jezebel.
Right.
All right. These are mental illnesses, even though sometimes it's temporary.
Yes.
King Saul suffered manic depression, and I believe that he was bipolar and he was psychotic.
Yes.
He kept trying to kill David.
Yes.
Okay. And then he would say, I'm sorry. God wouldn't have me to do such a thing. And then he turned around and tried to kill him again.
Try to do it again.
Okay.
Yeah, it sounds like bipolar. Mm-hmm.
That's straight bipolar, schizo. Man. He was schizo.
And bipolar was like, all I know is how I feel.
Yeah. You look at King Nebuchadnezzar. He went straight mad.
Yes.
You know, he stood out there and he says, look what I built. And God made him eat grass like a cow. He was straight. What a fool.
What it was, he saw his little cat, right? You know, and everybody know when cat's stomach get to feeling funny, they go out there and start grazing on the grass. And that's all I got.
Okay. Next. Look at...
we listened to him.
Right.
Yeah,
and we sit there and listen. We gave him about 5 seconds. And that was the worst 5 seconds of my life. And look at Nero, who burned the city down, blamed it on the Christians, took his violin out and had a jam session. Okay, that was straight psychotic.
Mm-hmm.
Okay,
but he came from a long line of that.
Okay, don't matter. He was psychopath. Okay, so.
And then drinking stuff out of lead pitchers didn't help any.
Mm-hmm. So before we went on a break, which we're going to go on one another again, what are the roles of psychotherapy? Okay. And drugs and religion. I mentioned that there is no role for secular psychotherapy.
Mm-hmm.
All right, mental health does not exist for the unbeliever.
Mm-hmm.
Okay, I left y'all on that cliffhanger, and then y'all went go to use the bathroom. All right.
Oh, should have known. Forgot something.
Now watch this. He can only exchange. Here's what the unbelieving psychologist can do.
Okay.
He can only exchange one problem for another problem.
Yes, that's true.
Your friend, Iyanla and Van Zant.
Iyanla.
Yeah, that chick. Okay.
Miss Van Zant.
Okay. She got a new book out. All right. Now, how can you understand a man except you know the spirit of a man? Okay, you got to know the spirit of man.
Mm-hmm.
All right, that's what scriptures say.
Mm-hmm.
I mean, because how can you know God? Because
right.
He's a spirit.
Mm-hmm.
All right, and you can't even worship him except in spirit and what?
Mm-hmm.
And in truth. All right, so when y'all listen to people like Van Zandt, sometimes I look at that show she has.
Mm-hmm.
All right, she takes a problem that you have and try to give you another problem. And if it's not a spiritual resolved,
mm-hmm.
then you're still having a problem. You got to build. You're taking a natural thing and building on another natural thing, building on another natural thing.
Right.
But the sometimes the easy fix is your relationship with the Lord.
Mm-hmm.
Okay.
Mm-hmm.
Unfortunately, when you don't insert Him into any of these problems, you're walking around in a circle like the children of Israel.
This is true.
For 40 years.
That's true.
So that's why I said you can't give a man your mind and he don't know God. So mm-hmm. you give him your mind, which is the battleground.
Yes.
For good and evil.
Mm-hmm.
And you give it to a man who's evil.
Mm-hmm.
Now, how do you define evil?
Ungodly. Mm-hmm.
How do you define evil?
Anything that moves against the natural order of things, which has been set down by God.
Okay. All right.
Ungodly, like I said.
Yeah,
but you got to define ungodly. Define ungodly for me, sister.
That's a good question.
That is a good question. What's the answer, Sir Walter?
He said sister. Now, yeah. You turning me into sister.
Oh, no.
Yeah, yeah. I mean.
Well, he got all detailed. I just simplified it.
Uh-huh. A man who don't know God, he's ungodly. Here's where people may disagree with you on this, but unfortunately, it's because you don't know God. When you call a man evil because he don't know God,
mm-hmm.
and you say, how could you? He's not evil. Now you got to define what evil is.
Right.
All right. Right. Okay. Well, any absence from the Lord is evil.
Mm-hmm.
You can't live in darkness and
right.
then there be light present.
Sure.
Okay.
Because that's good.
You live in darkness. So so the absence of Christ in your life is evil, mm-hmm. pure and simple.
Mm-hmm.
You probably say, well, there's a lot of good people out there who don't go to church, who don't know God is good. Yeah, they're good people
mm-hmm.
on the outside, what yeah. you see. But when they die, guess where they're going? So why would God send good people to hell?
Right, right.
You know
that's a good question, but that brings up a whole nother subject.
Uh-huh.
Because then there's still... The people is widely known. The word is at this particular point, there are still people who are born, live, and die without ever hearing the gospel.
Yes, and we can do a show on that art. You just gave me an idea.
That's deep.
Yeah.
Yeah, because at the time of Jesus,
uh-huh.
that was a whole globe
uh-huh.
didn't know what was going on
sure.
or where he was.
We can talk about that after the break.
All right.
Okay. Hey, what I got up there? I got a song?
Music playing, man.
Not right now, but on the back end. You want a song right here?
Back on? The back end is fine.
Okay.
We just take do a station break and come right back.
Yeah.
Because people don't want to wait no longer. Okay. All right. I'll be back.
Uh-huh.
You know, I didn't come here to preach to you today. But you know, I feel good. I feel good because I know there's a God somewhere. There's a God somewhere. You know there's a God who sits on high and looks down low. Man cannot make it like this.
Broadcasting all over the world at urbanbroadcastmedia.com. Delivering love and inspiration
24/7.
This is UBM Praise. The following show is paid programming and does not necessarily express the views and opinions of Urban Broadcast Media and its subsidiaries.
Thank you for listening to UBM
so
Praise.
Where can one go to find nice women here?
Oh, you got to go to a nice place, a quiet place like a library. It's a good woman there. And at church, it's good girls.
A Sir Walter Jones.
Who is it?
A Sir Walter Jones.
What's his name?
A Sir Walter Jones.
Whose show is this?
A Sir Walter Jones.
Who is it?
A Sir Walter Jones.
Say it again.
A Sir Walter Jones.
Who are you with?
A Sir Walter Jones.
One more game.
A Sir Walter Jones.
The Sir Walter Jones Show. Co-host Alvin Carter. We are a Christian talk show in where we tackle all the hot topics in a believer's walk.
That's right.
A Sir Walter Jones.
Who is it?
A Sir Walter Jones.
What's his name?
A Sir Walter Jones.
Whose show is this?
A Sir Walter Jones.
Ladies, it's Tuesday. Pink Perspectives.
Tuesday.
On the Sir Walter Jones Show. Right here on UBM Praise.
Welcome back. That was a short break. We're trying to behave in the studio, but
no.
as long as D and Art is here, there is no behaving.
How'd I get thrown in there?
I have no idea.
Oh, no.
Yeah, the role of a Baptist. Anyway.
Yeah. The large majority of mental disorders could be solved with biblical conversions and obedience to the Lord. Believe it or not, a large percentage of them.
Really?
Yep. Those with deep psychological issues need to be placed in a more mentally protective environment. Mm-hmm. So they have to guard their gates.
Okay.
That's why the Bible says, I keep you in perfect peace whose mind is stayed on me. Mm-hmm. So when we go to church and stand in that line in the altar call, we lay hands on them, sling oil on them, and send them back home to that same environment they came from.
Yes.
Monday through Saturday, and they're going to be coming back to your altar call line next week.
Next week.
Because they'll still come back mentally ill.
Exactly.
So we have to do more than just sling oil on them.
Yes.
And the ones who are laying hands on them, a lot of them are powerless anyway.
And a lot of them have mental illnesses too.
Yes. So you got the wrong people laying hands on people because they have no power. There's nothing coming out of their hands. Okay.
Not the right stuff.
Yeah, you see what I'm saying? So these same people, year after year after year, are going back into the same environment. So yes. Something's wrong in the church.
Yeah, something's very wrong.
Yeah.
You know, you mentioned earlier about how come we don't embrace Christian psychologists or refer people to them. You know, I think we're still captive in our minds, a lot of us, even with the entire subject of psychology. When you can't embrace it, then how are you going to refer? Or you may think that, again, that's a clash, Christian and psychologists. Mm-hmm. You may not, okay, why would I refer you over there when I really don't believe that they can?
Right, it's a psychology. All you got to do is stop sinning, get on your knees and pray.
So they give you those results.
Get some of this vegetable oil, slap it on your forehead, you be all
right. Right. I mean, which, you know, vegetable oil. Jeez. And I'm saying right.
Olive's not a vegetable?
Right. That's what we admit.
Well, yeah. I mean, I understand.
Make sure it's extra virgin, though. Go ahead.
Yeah.
Because the one
who... Don't want any of that tainted.
Yeah. Make sure it's extra virgin. I mean, that's virgin, then there's extra virgin.
That's what they say cooking.
That's right. That, now, it may burn, but it's still... Okay, what are you saying?
Yeah, back to our regular scheduled program. Now, here's where I tend to get into trouble because people think that I am pushing away prayer, pushing away, you know, the things that we do in the mm-hmm. church. I'm not. But again, I believe God allows Christians to go to school and study psychology and to learn about it and to help address these situations.
True enough. I mean, how can you go ahead and define a chemical imbalance versus, you know, something else? If you don't go to school to study and understand these things, then you can't go ahead and define what that particular problem is. You'll constantly be calling it something else.
Right. Right. And so then you won't, like he was mentioning earlier, you won't push your children or encourage them to go, or, you know, the young people or whoever's going to school, you want to encourage them to go into those areas of study because you don't really think that there is, if I can say it, any help in that area for you.
That's because the devil's name is Sigmund Freud.
Say what?
Okay. All right.
Hanging out with that other devil, Nietzsche.
Nietzsche.
I'm going to pray for you.
Yeah, that's right. Okay, so then let's talk about that. All right? When you have a problem in your body, mm-hmm. whether it's a pain in your body or whether it's cancer,
right.
They call you all up to the altar and everybody gather around you and they pray at church. Mm-hmm. And then what they do is then they say, now you go to the doctor tomorrow.
Mm-hmm.
All right? Now, why are they sending you back to the doctor?
So that you can get a report, basically.
Yes, because, right, they need a report
mm-hmm.
so that the church could have a testimony
yes.
to rejoice over.
And they can jump around.
Okay, but they pray for you.
First. Right.
They did, right?
Yes.
Okay, but when it comes to the mind, why can't they do the same thing with the mind? Says, okay, now we done prayed over you, mm-hmm. now go to the doctor.
Right.
Okay, to the psychiatrist,
yes.
the psychologist, whoever, and then bring back a report
back
that you're
report.
Not crazy no more.
That's two reasons.
Again, because
huh?
it's taboo.
Okay.
It's taboo. You mm-hmm. cannot touch that. You cannot mix psychology mm-hmm. in with Christianity or Bible. You, mm-hmm. you well, that, that's come
you
along
can't
through
mix
the years.
It. You got two problems inside the black church. One, mm-hmm. that's a white man's disease.
Right.
White man's disease.
Two,
okay.
Well, there you go. It's white man's disease.
Right.
Hey, hoes, what about our people, bro?
Only white people go crazy, getting nuts. And because they don't know God, so therefore they're...
We got a disease,
man, you what? You leave my ancestors alone.
Okay.
Alrighty. I have not touched you there.
I'm going to ask you guys a question.
Yes.
Let's talk about medications.
Because these two need it.
Yes, because they're not on theirs right now. Right. Let's talk about medication.
I haven't had a chance to roll any.
All right. I'm gonna call out these medications.
Yes.
And y'all tell me if you recognize.
Okay.
All right. You ready?
I can't hear a thing.
Okay. Paxil.
Yes.
What?
Prozac.
Yes.
Oh yeah.
Zalexa.
Yep.
Zoloft.
Yep. Yes. Mm-hmm.
Lexapro.
Yes.
No.
Zyban.
Yeah. Yep.
Yeah. I know him.
Chantix.
Yeah.
Yeah.
Adderall.
Yes.
Ritalin.
Yes. Oh, yeah.
Oh, yeah.
Xanax.
Yeah. Yep.
Wellbutrin.
Mm-hmm. Yeah.
No.
Valium.
Yeah.
Oh, yeah.
Lyrica.
Yeah. I know her.
Okay.
She hang out with
Cialis. Uh-huh. Right. She hang out with Cialis.
Yeah, and Levitra, too.
Okay. Now, why do y'all recognize all of these medicines?
Commercials.
Because they're advertised so much. Mm-hmm. Because there are so many different mental illnesses in the world that they're trying to address.
Okay. And some of these are not mental illness. Some of these are just some imbalance of...
chemical imbalances.
Things like that and cholesterol and what have you. Okay. Now, the U.S. ranks number one in anxiety disorder in the entire world.
Wonder
that's
why.
Interesting.
Number one. Yes.
Can we put a pin in it?
Yes. Yes.
Why are we the richest country? Why are we so anxious?
Because we have the freedom to be nuts.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, well, that is true. As funny as that is, that's true.
That's true.
90% of Americans experience a clinical anxiety disorder in a given 12-month period.
Well, how about we're always, this is such a fast-paced society. We're always trying to get ahead. We're always trying to make more money.
Trying to live that dream.
So that alone can drive
y'all
you up the
really
wall.
Tripping.
Can drive you crazy.
Always trying to get some hit.
The U.S. ranks 6th in assaults.
Wow.
New Zealand, Canada, and Zimbabwe is safer than us.
Wow.
Zimbabwe is safer. 6th in assaults.
We need to move.
The United States ranks 54th to commitment to organic farming. U.S. ranks 3rd in beef consumption.
Oh, wow. Yeah. You say steak make me crazy.
Yep. United States ranks 1st in milk consumption.
Man. And you know what? Humans are the only adult animal that drinks milk.
Goes great with cookies.
No, y'all drink it. I don't. But go ahead.
India's number 2 and Pakistan's number 3. Okay? And the milk that we're drinking.
India drinks milk.
Yeah, number 2.
Outstanding.
Because that's their holy cow. They worship the cow.
They don't eat the meat, but they drink the elixir.
Yeah,
that's
swallow.
Right.
And the milk we're drinking, unfortunately, is not the pure milk.
No, it's pasteurized.
That was original. Yeah, it's not. So it's not really helping us.
I wonder if we ever drank some fresh cow milk, would it taste the same?
No.
It doesn't?
I'm from the South. No, it
doesn't. What's the difference? Is it sweeter? Is it less sweet?
The texture. Everything about it is different. Some of it is a little thinner.
Okay.
And, well, it depends on if you like 2%. But it does have a sweeter taste to it. And there's this other flavor I can't quite identify. It's been over 47 years since I've had some last. But that still sticks with me.
Yep. The U.S. Wow. ranks 4th in sugar consumption.
Mm-hmm.
Who eats more sugar than us?
I don't know yet.
Wow.
The U.S. ranks 5th in amphetamine use, which treats ADD and narcolepsy.
Mm-hmm.
Okay. The U.S. is number 1. Right.
Oh, I'm sorry.
The U.S. is number 1 in cocaine use. Number 1. The U.S. is 3rd in garbage.
Number 1 in cocaine use.
Number 1.
Wow.
Yeah, ain't nobody else crazy enough to use this stuff.
Right. Even the ones who produce
they don't use it.
I know, but you know what?
They sell it, but they don't use it.
No.
They eat the leaves, but they don't eat the chemical powder.
Well, if you saw how they made it, Lord.
We are number 3 in juvenile crime suspects.
Really?
Yep. We are 1st in mood disorders. That's why I mentioned all these medicines.
Mm-hmm. Oh, my nerves. I don't feel like
we are... 8th in female obesity.
Wait. Wait. Oh wow! Eight. See that now. See that's a statistic we could have had earlier. Mm-hmm. What other country got bigger women than us?
Right.
I just want to know that. That's
you know what?
I didn't write
eight.
It down.
I will go eight. Ahead. And
eighth
I will,
and female and fifth and male.
I will go uh-huh. ahead and consult that's the great guru Google.
Yeah, but watch this. But we're second in all the physicians around the world.
Wow.
Yeah, because they leave other countries and come here.
That's right. Because we have all
work.
The problems. Yes. Uh huh.
There's more work. And there's no work over
well,
here.
Well, yeah, he just read all the problems.
There's no uh-huh. work over here. Nobody's sick.
But watch this. Y'all keep calling us the most wealthiest nation, but we're number three in poverty.
Mm.
Mexico is number one.
All that alone to
who's
make
number
you
stressed.
Two? I don't know.
No.
U.S. ranks number one in prisoners.
Oh. Mm. That's a whole other demographic.
That's because we
yes.
catch.
Yeah, yes.
Anyway.
We
that's
number
a whole
one.
Other demographic.
Yes. Yeah.
Which uh-huh. makes the collection of the data skeptical.
Oh, no. I think we imprison more people in the
world. Oh, no. We have
world.
More people in prison yes. than any other place in the world. Yeah. But if you count that demographic alone, both mm-hmm. male and female, even though they're separate, if you take that demographic of people, you can come up with a whole nother set of data mm-hmm. that addresses all of that.
Oh, I see what you're saying. Yeah. Yeah. I think,
so when they say U.S., are they talking about those prisoners? Are they including the prisoners in their count, which may change the ranking?
Sure. Well, I think of all of the prisons we have in the United States, no matter what color they are, race they are, they're in our prisons. Okay.
Yeah.
Yeah. Which can go into another discussion because
from us by us
mm-hmm, because we could be holding people who are we're going to be deporting soon because they committed a crime over there and we were told to hold them. So I don't know.
Wow.
Is there no bomb in Gilead?
Mm.
Is there no physician there?
Mm.
You know, there's a lot of medical, medicinal terminology in the Bible.
Yes.
Even the Apostle Paul was talking to Timothy and told him to drink wine or take wine.
It'll look good for the stomach.
Yeah, yeah, for the stomach's sake.
My stomach. Hurt.
Uh-huh. Because the boy was
flask,
dealing with the...
Well, I got to have a flask.
You look like a drunk.
Yeah. That's a carpenter's look, thank you.
Yeah. When trying to repair a physical or a mental problem, you must always involve a spiritual response mm-hmm. during this process.
Mm.
When a brick mason drills through a brick wall, he sometimes, now Art knows this, what does he spray on the brick while he's drilling?
Water.
Why?
Or oil. To
why?
Keep the bit cool.
Mm.
And keep down dust.
Mm-hmm. So when you're sweeping dust, like I said, you also
water.
Yes,
you put water.
Oil.
Absolutely. There you go.
Water or oil.
Now preach that. Preach that message.
Huh. We've seen a little water. The water causes a lubrication mm-hmm. that also cuts down on the friction.
Uh-huh.
The oil also cutting down on friction causes about a system called coagulation, which
yes,
brings
sir.
Things together. But when you have water and water together, oil and water don't mix. However,
yes,
together they can work together to bring about a conclusion.
Yes,
they
sir.
Can help you reach a goal.
Mm-hmm.
Hallelujah. You need the water of the Holy Ghost and the oil of the Word.
Hallelujah. That's it. That's it. You see? Because all things work together for
the good of them that love the Lord.
The call according.
Now I'm thirsty. I need a drink of water.
Yeah, that's right. So you got to fix these problems. You spray some spirituality on it, and it'll level it all off. I love that.
Yeah,
so
level it all off. And
I
still
like
got a hole in my head from a wet, dry brick.
Yeah,
yes.
Yeah. Yeah. Mm-hmm. Mm-hmm.
I needed that.
So the root cause of all men's problems is sin. Really is.
Okay.
It's the root cause.
Oh, wretched man that I am.
Oh, wretched man that I am. Psychiatric medication may be understood as a legitimate outworking of the dominion function. We're talking about dominion here.
Mm-hmm.
But merely as an imperfect attempt to mitigate sin's effects on the present physical order, it cannot solve mankind's primary problem, which is sin. So medication doesn't fix sin.
Right.
So
yes.
you give medication, right, because they give medication to a bipolar person.
Mm-hmm.
Or
treatment
kid.
Is not a cure.
Right, right. Mm-hmm. It's just, what is it?
Treatment. It just uh-huh. offers a little bit of relief.
Exactly.
Temporarily.
Temporary.
It.
Yeah, so the problem is still there.
Mm-hmm.
You just
get to the root of it.
Covering over it.
Well, actually, kind of trying to, should at that particular point, stabilizing the situation, just like when you have a traumatic injury to the body, you have mm-hmm. to stabilize it first before you can go in and knit it back together. Mm-hmm. When they give the treatment.
Yeah, but don't leave it at the stage.
But when they leave it at the, when they give the medication to the bipolar individual, that is to stabilize them to go in and go to work. Unless, of course, you just want to keep fattening your pockets and stuff with government grants and things like that, then you just keep the treatment.
That's another
show. All right. Since medication falls under Dominion as an attempt to address the effects of the fall, we know what the fall is, Adam. Mm-hmm. Psychiatric drug use should seek to restore regular brain functioning. In cases of injury and underdevelopment, this could mean compensation for what is damaged or absent. In cases of uncontrollable excesses of deficiencies of neural transmitters or hormones, it could mean stabilizing the brain's regulatory functions. Okay, now if this is not making any sense to you, rewind it on Spreaker and then play it over and then you'll get it.
Can you give me a lot of information?
One caution. Psychiatric medicine should not be used in depletive fashion. For instance, to numb a proper neurological response.
Mm-hmm.
For example, numbing the effects of grief would be depletive.
Yes.
In grieving the loss of a loved one, medication could hinder proper functioning of the embodied soul.
Mm-hmm.
That circumstance often makes people most experimental, experientially aware of their belief and desires, and this is a key opportunity for strengthening faith. Medicating a person out of this opportunity could be more sophisticated way of escaping from grief by getting drunk on alcohol.
Mm. Okay, so that's basically in what layman's term, kill you make you stronger.
Mm-hmm.
Well, yeah, or in layman's terms, when I can't deal with it, I deceive myself by drowning in a bottle.
That's it.
Exactly.
That's it.
And when you come to, the situation is still there.
So somebody when he got a PhD for something that what's the guy name in Mayberry? Otis. What Otis discovered years ago.
Mm-hmm.
And if you allow me to digress, Otis the wino in Mayberry was actually married with a wife and a home.
That's right.
Yeah, he was.
But
he
was so miserable.
Mm-hmm. Yes.
Ain't B, they couldn't leave him in the jail. They sent him home, and Ain't B decided to clean him up. And when she found out he was married, sent him home. He went back home. His wife didn't recognize him. He went back home, and his wife began to nag, fuss, holler, scream, do this, do that, do this. He said, please, I need a drink. Yes. Please, please. He would rather be drunk and homeless to numb himself from the misery of the pain of maturation and responsibility.
That's good.
Than to be.
So, can I ask a question? Mm-hmm. Today is Tuesday, right?
Yeah.
Women's Perspective.
Right.
Pink Perspective.
Did you, or Pink Perspective, thank you. Did you call me on here because women are mentally ill? No,
yeah, women are crazy.
Yes.
Truthfully,
I think I'm being set up.
Yeah. Sure, no, but you got a mind, see?
You got a mind. How you walk.
You are that dangerous creature from which most men cringe.
You are that one woman that knows how to manipulate and push buttons.
Yeah.
And you can take all this information from us.
Let him talk.
Like you just did and flipped it, see?
Yeah.
Like you just did. You just flipped it. We think we've been smart and you just identified it. Now you about to boomerang all that on us because you know how mind, body, and soul
work. There you go.
You're going to take the sole of your feet. Put it on our body because we done made your mind mad.
Mind, body, and soul.
I love it. Keep it.
Heart is a troll.
Woo! Don't kick me so hard. Don't make me lose control.
myself. Escapism.
Wow.
Many sufferers take medicine in order to avoid dealing with the true cause of their ailment.
Yes.
Oh, my God.
This will be denying responsibility, denying God's healing, and possibly denying others from the freedom of forgiveness or closure to some past event that could be contributing to the ailment.
Mm-hmm.
This then does become a sin as it is based on selfishness.
Mm-hmm.
So someone offended you, so you go and medicate yourself and all this other stuff. Okay,
right.
But really,
let me go smoke a cigarette before I cuss them out.
Yeah, absolutely.
Right.
But God says, you know, before you even come and give your offerings, what have you, said, leave your blessings and all that stuff at the altar. Go make it right with the brother and stop escaping. And that's what the church do. We do. We escape stuff. Because we want to be mad. I think a lot of us want to be angry, want to unforgive someone. We just
want to be mad.
They enjoy it.
They want vindication.
Yeah.
But now, I'm going to be honest with you. That's funny you say that because I used to refuse to fight with a person.
Yeah.
I'm probably going to receive a text when I say this. Mm-hmm. I will say, you have a right to that anger. Enjoy your anger. I'll talk to you later when you finish with
it. Oh, Denzel Washington, somebody mad at you, put a cape on them and say, nah, you're super mad. Mm-hmm. Yeah, I like that. Mm-hmm.
Yeah. Familiar spirits. Some avenues through which demons or familiar spirits can gain entrance into the body that the person's life are divination, transcendental medication, visualization, necromancy, witchcraft, drugs, alcohol.
Necromancy.
Necrophilia.
Absolutely. That's necromancy.
Yeah, yeah.
Hey, dead mama, how you doing? That's necrophilia with romance. Necromancy.
That's it.
Not quite, but anyway.
Yeah. That's from familiar spirits.
Man, I got to go to that funeral, man. She looked good, lad.
Oh, Jesus.
Yeah, but it's funny, but it's true.
It is true.
The succubus and the incubus spirits.
Yes.
Okay, both succubus and incubus were the products of medieval superstitions and were most likely efforts to explain the natural phenomenon that occurred during sleep. So there's nightmares, sexual dreams, sleep paralysis, and night terrors, and all that stuff.
Actually, Lilith was supposed to be the first succubus.
When we talked about that last week.
Yep.
Yeah. Why are you bringing that fictitious character up? I don't understand how people keep going to Lilith talking about she's the first woman. I don't believe that now.
The first succubus. Yeah. And since this is a Jewish myth, and Christianity is the second stage from Judaism, take it up with the Jew, because it's their myth.
I'm talking to Jew, man. I'm talking to Jew.
That's right, yeah. How do we know if a mental illness is spiritual or biochemical?
Great question.
All right, and that's what we want to get into, okay? Beware of the chameleon.
Yes.
All right, the chameleon.
There are a lot of chameleons around.
Yeah.
Boom, 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 boom.
Yeah, that's Isaiah. Is that Grover?
Herbie Hancock,
Chameleon.
Oh, Herbie Hancock. Yeah, that one. Dagon, Bell.
The name of the song is Chameleon. That's why.
Yeah, Astaroth.
I understand, but it's amazing how you all are mentally ill.
Yes, we are very much.
That was musical.
But go ahead.
Yeah,
that's musical ill.
Which you had to be mentally ill in order to be that musically talented. Beelzebub, Moloch.
I mean, a bunch of musicians doing a talk show.
Yeah,
come on. Crazy is
who
that?
Who does that? That's who does that and be successful at it?
Go ahead. I'm sorry, Sir Walter.
Yeah.
Go run the board.
That's like Fox saying they love Obama. Beware.
Just joined right on in.
She did. This is crazy.
David and Jesus is our answer to how to minister to mental illness people. Okay, so let's talk about how do we minister to them. All right. James 4:7. Maybe we can analyze that. James 4:7. You got it. Who got it? Real quick.
James
4:7.
You should know that. Oh, James. I thought this. Never mind.
Who has it?
Yeah. Yeah, he flipping the script. Okay, as you're looking for that, y'all remember the Columbine shooting?
Yes. Yeah.
Okay, with Eric Harris and Dylan Clyborn, I believe his name was.
Yeah, the trench coat mafia.
Yeah, the trench coat mafia. Okay, that was a tragic event.
Wow. Yeah.
But there's something. But see, they were known as having mental illnesses because they suffered with some depression and some other things.
James 4:7.
Uh huh. Yeah.
Submit yourselves, therefore, to God. Resist the devil, and he will flee from you.
Okay. How do you resist the devil? You ignore him? I mean, how do you resist him?
There are many ways.
What does the resistance mean?
A lot of times, to not entertain.
Okay. Yielding not.
Yeah. Okay.
That's good.
So, yield not.
Yeah. Even though the urge comes,
uh-huh.
you have to use your know better over your do better.
Okay.
I want to do it, but I just know better, so I ain't. But the second scripture that follows that says, draw nigh to God.
Okay.
And he will draw nigh to you.
Okay. Okay.
And it says, cleanse your hands, ye sinners, and purify your hearts, ye double-minded.
Mm-hmm. Yeah.
Because there's two minds at work when you're in that didactic.
Yeah.
Or dynamic, where you're deciding. You know, the cartoons just do it so well. They have the angel on your shoulder and the devil on your shoulder.
Right.
If I do it, I did a whipping.
Right.
I do it, you know, because flesh always seems to win because that person uses reason versus worship.
Yes. Yes.
You know, I think also what we have to also remember and keep in mind is everything starts in the mind.
Right.
So you have to program your mind. You know, a lot of times, yeah, you may feel like doing it or whatever that is. Oh, gosh, I forgot I was here with Alvin Carter.
Why you?
I'm so sorry.
Yes, but sometimes you just feel like doing it, Alvin.
So, my point is that so you're going to have to program your mind. Okay, mm-hmm. Don't even think that way. So this is how you can draw nigh to God. You know, resist the devil. Okay, I'm not going to even think that way. I'm not going to, think about that. I'm going to try to program my mind, resist what he's presenting to me.
But for some people, that actually builds a trap for them. It's like, well, in my particular instance, in the military, they give you little keys to mm-hmm. make you so you could cope with the things that you would have to do that you was always raised that you just don't do. So they give you little key factors such as target. Mm-hmm. Well, target is a person.
Okay.
Okay, but in my mind at that time, instead of trying to desensitize the target, I made the target as real as possible.
Mm-hmm.
This person has a life just like I have. Okay. They have dreams. They have this, that, and other, and blah, 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 blah. But I have to stop it right here and there.
Okay. Well, before I go to a break, my point, I lost my ears, so somebody had to plug me back in. With Columbine, when Dylan and that boy went in there to shoot up everybody,
mm-hmm.
They were shooting people successfully. They were shooting these kids and shooting them dead, okay? But then what happened was they walked up into a young man.
Uh-huh.
And they were shooting and they saw this young man. They said, "Hey, Bill." And Bill was like, "Hey, Dylan. Hey, Yo-Yo," or whatever his name was. And they mm-hmm. walked right by him.
Right.
And then started shooting again.
Yeah.
And he escaped.
Yeah.
Why did that happen?
Because the young guy, whoever he was, Bill, would always speak to them. And
that's it. And you know, he knew, and because they were ostracized, because mm-hmm. they were black code, what have you, everybody ignored him, teased right. him, except this young man.
Except him.
Uh-huh. And this is what we want to talk about in this last half hour is how do we deal with those who are mentally ill, whether it's depression, bipolar, mm-hmm. or what have you. How do we treat them? Not treat them medically, I mean right, treat right, them, right. you know.
Respond. How do we socially respond to this?
Absolutely. Without there being such a catastrophe as what happened there. Because mm-hmm. this happened to me on my job. Mm-hmm. Okay, a guy who everybody ignored got fired, all right? And he walked in there with an artillery outfit on. What's that outfit where they...
Ballistic look, suit.
Yeah, and he walked in there and he freaked out the entire company, okay? Mm. They were running and dashing for their chairs and what have you under the tables. And he came in my office and he waved, "Hey, Walter, how you doing, man? It's good to see you," okay?
Wow.
I freaked out, but I said, something came with me and said, "Well, I'm going to be okay," because mm-hmm. I'm the only one that talks to this guy and takes him out to lunch.
See there?
Uh-huh, yeah. And I'll tell you what happened after that.
That's
we're going
good
to
segue.
Yeah, Controversial Corner.
All right.
And we'll come back. Sir Walter Jones Show.
Log on to UrbanBroadcastMedia.com and check out the many services Urban Broadcast Media provides. Whether it's social media, video production, radio broadcasting, or audio recording, we got you covered. The show is paid programming and does not necessarily express the views and opinions of Urban Broadcast Media and its subsidiaries.
Thank you for listening to UBM Praise.
Oh, shifting, shifting the atmosphere for breakthrough and healing. Our worship is shifting, shifting, shifting the and it's breaking. How about that? This worship is shifting the atmosphere.
Shifting the atmosphere.
Every yoke is destroyed. Every chain is broken. This worship is shifting the atmosphere.
Shifting the atmosphere.
It's breaking. Our worship is shifting the atmosphere.
Shifting the atmosphere.
Till the heavens are open for breakthrough and healing. This worship is shifting the atmosphere.
Shifting the atmosphere.
It's moving and it's breaking. My brain is shifting the atmosphere.
You know, God's unchanging hand, because he helped Joshua fight the battle of Jericho. Yes, he helped Daniel get out the lion's den. He helped Gilligan get off the island. Lord.
Ladies, it's Tuesday. Pink Perspectives on the Sir Walter Jones Show, right here on UBM Praise.
Tuesday, Tuesday, Tuesday.
That's right.
At this time, I have the honor to present to you the moral leader of our nation.
That's right.
At this time, I have the honor to present to you the moral leader of our nation, a great, dedicated man, a philosopher of a non-violent system of
behavior. Due to some violent content, parental discretion is advised.
Politics, doctrine, current events. Let's meet at the Controversy Corner on the Sir Walter Jones Show, here on UBM Praise.
This is Keep It Real Carter here at the intersection of insanity and crazy folks. I have a question. Why is it that when people get sick in their heart, in their lungs, they injure a bone or a muscle on their bodies, we have all the compassion in the world for them, we show them all the love, but we forget that the mind is an organ, just like your liver, just like your pancreas. It's an organ. It just manifests its illness a different way. How come when the mind, that organ, and I ain't talking about a B3 for you church folk, the organ begins to malfunction, and because of the way it manifests itself, we immediately demonify it. Now, I'm not saying that it's not through to demonic influence, but that's no different than when someone is born with a birth defect. Does that baby who has one less limb have a demon? Because that other, as much as the baby who's born with a little bit of mental illness or retardation. We actually show how crazy we are because we try to make sense out of stuff that don't make sense to us by using or blaming the devil. Put devil in the corner saying, I get blamed for everything, even the stuff I didn't do. Now, crazy may be, but crazy people may still be, they crazy they may be, but people still have feelings. That's what I'm trying to say. crazy they may be, but people, they have feelings. And they haven't touched, they have a sense of sense about their emotions. So you say, I'm going to just pray for you. Well, I got a question for you. If your prayers are reaching heaven, why don't you reach out on earth? I'm not talking about laying hands on them. I'm not trying to talk about slapping them. But I'm talking about shaking their hand for a minute, giving them a hug, letting them know that you recognize that they still have a human spirit. Let them know that you recognize that they still matter. They have something to contribute. Everyone is uniquely endowed with a certain mixture of abilities and opportunities, and no mixture is insignificant. Now, we do some foolish things, but they don't call us crazy. Bible says a fool says in his heart that there is no God, but we don't act very godly when it comes to crazy people. So I think the fool, you're just as crazy as they are. You're just meeting on a different level of crazy. All right. Oh, I'm sorry. Now, we act so ungodly sometimes.
Just like them.
That they begin to react to you the way they see you, and you wonder why they treat you the way they do. Because they feel just as offended as you do to them. Now, the word fool is mentioned in another context. It says, we are fools for Christ's sake. So I close this controversial topic with a controversial question. What kind of fool are you?
What kind of fool am I? Yes. Strangers in the night. We can go there.
Yeah, you act strange at night. I've seen you walk the street.
Controversial corner right here, y'all. 5:30 every day, Monday through Friday. Right here, you being praised. You know what I have discovered? That Christians are just too spiritual in that.
Yes.
We're too spiritual.
Too spiritual.
Yeah, we are Holy Ghost fools. When we just everything that we interact in, we go crazy over. Because we're so heavily minded.
There were no earthly good.
Now, Galileo.
Can I stop you right there? Mm-hmm. We actually go crazy when something is supposedly good.
Yeah, that's true.
We become fanatics, but we just call them fans.
Yeah.
Can you see how some of the shifts that have happened and ministries have been changed because of the craze, quote unquote, that takes place with the sensationalism of this new approach to ministry?
Mm-hmm. Yeah. Yeah. And you're right. You're absolutely right. And it has tainted the minds of the people who have a little bit of intelligence can't get a word in edgewise, because y'all say that ain't of God, because God is not intelligent.
Then you start speaking an intelligible language of tongues.
Yes, there you go.
And shunning logic.
Now, history repeats itself. Galileo. Galileo, y'all know him.
Yeah.
Okay, I believe it was Galileo. He said that the earth rotates around the sun. All right, and it got him silenced by the Catholic Church.
Sure did.
Okay, because they said, no, that is not true. And then they put him on house arrest. Mm-hmm. Years later... they realized that he was right because it appears that the sun is moving around. But in essence, we're the one moving around.
Right.
So they had to call it apparent motion because it just appeared that we're the one moving. And because the Catholic Church was just so spiritual minded, like the Protestant Church of today. It is hard for me to go walk up to some people of some certain denominations and say hello, and they'll say, I said hello, man.
Right.
Don't can you say hello back? Okay, so I think we got too caught up. David says, you know, he said, I was once young, now I'm old.
Yes, you are.
You know, and he look at the silliness of artists dying over here. So what happened was the writers of the Bible looked at every physical illness and he said that it was a result of a man's sin.
Oh no.
The boy was born blind, and the Jews thought, well, it had to have been his parents or him who
somebody's sin.
Yeah, and Jesus healed him and says, no, he's not blind because he sinned or his parents sinned. He's blind because so that I can heal him in front of y'all. Thank you.
That's a great exegesis of the meaning. This is done for those of you who don't believe.
For those who don't believe. He said the same thing when he raised Lazarus from the dead.
Yes.
He said, because of for y'all don't believe, Lazarus, get up out of there. All right, now, this is why we think that all mental illness is a result of demons or epilepsy or whatever it's called, okay? We think it's all absorbed, but that is not necessarily so, because some things that y'all are eating causes this thing that happens in your mind.
And we're eating devils.
Yeah. So we
got the devil of gluttony.
You got the devil. You got devil to this, devil to this. And
devil,
that's why
pork.
America is a nation that is very sick. Abraham and Isaac and Jacob, they drank dairy from their own flocks, okay? But today, the Jewish people in America can't tolerate our dairy.
It
Why is
something.
That? Yeah. The Mashi tribes of Africa, they thrived on dairy, but African Americans can't tolerate it.
Tainted.
I have, what do you call that thing?
Lactose intolerance.
Yeah. Indians worship the cows, we're talking about in India, but here, Eastern Indians can't tolerate the milk. Okay? America's cow milk is toxic to the body. Yeah.
It's that vitamin D. You know what the D stand for, don't you?
Mm-hmm. No. Mm-hmm.
Yeah. Detriment.
Devil.
Yeah. Yeah. Yes. Yeah.
Oh, no.
Thomas Jefferson. He said, if the people let government decide what foods they eat and what medicines they take, their bodies will soon be in as sorrow as a state as the souls of those who live under tyranny. Mm. So government regulates your food, and you let that happen, okay?
Right.
And then it's a systematic sickness, and there's a lot of money to be made in the you said it yesterday, Alvin.
Yes.
You create a problem, as you say to the Democrats did.
Yes.
And then you go back and you fix it.
Right.
Okay? It is a controlled chaos.
Yes. Exactly.
Well, yeah. Actually, that works in the retail business and commerce as well.
Yeah.
That's one of the ways that the Japanese automotive company excelled over the American motor car companies. I find it really funny in the movie RoboCop, the guy made a little machine, he comes in with the new prototype, and he said, what difference does it make if it worked or not? We could have made a bank off of just selling the repair parts.
Yeah, that's it.
And that's the way the system works.
That's it, man. Wow. You nailed it. The RX that's on your bottle, on the medicine
prescription
bottle.
Yes.
Yeah, you know what that stands for? Recipe.
Yeah.
That's what it is. Recipe.
Prescription is a recipe.
Uh-huh. So in Revelations 21 and 8, it talks about...
pharmakia means crazy.
And that's... Yeah, well, pharmakia is pharmacy, which is medicine, okay, in Revelation 21 and 8. So it says, in the last days, people will be hooked on sorcery, which is drugs.
Mm-hmm. Right.
People will be hooked on drugs.
Mm-hmm.
Pharmakia, and the RX on your bottle is recipe, which is a mixture. And that's why when you see the witch... You see her with this big pot.
Cauldron.
Uh-huh. Yeah.
Boils and bubbles.
That's straight sorcery. That. Absolutely. Yeah. Yeah. It all comes into play here. Okay. Mm-hmm. And so when you get hooked on these prescription drugs, you're caught up in pharmakia.
Exactly.
That's what that is. It's
sorcery. You're hooked in sorcery.
You're hooked on it. And so we need a spiritual detox.
Mm-hmm.
That's what we need. So we need to go back.
So then the sorcerer is actually
that's why
a drug
these
dealer.
Come out, but by fasting and praying.
That's right. And go back and do your first works all over again. And what is your first work? You got to return back to the Lord.
That's right.
Yes. Yeah, yeah.
Repent, love
the Lord your God with... Now watch this. He covered it. He said, love the Lord your God with what?
All your heart.
Your heart, what
your
else?
Your mind.
You okay?
Yes.
I'm trying to get you to love the Lord with your
actually,
soul, the show.
Mind, body, and soul.
Come on, I'm trying to set you up, Annette.
See that? Yeah. But she didn't say that spiritually.
No, she didn't.
Now I got to repent again.
Oh,
but you know what? In biblical times,
uh-huh.
I don't know how to say it.
The heart was thought to serve as the same function that we now know the brain does. Right. So when it goes into the heart, the mind was housed inside of the heart.
Uh-huh.
And we have a tendency to still think of this thing that pumps in our chest.
No. That's not the heart.
I know.
No, that's a blood pump.
Exactly.
Yeah. Yeah. You can't see the heart.
It's the seed of the emotion.
But you can feed. That's right. Yeah.
Ye old gray matter.
Back in the day, when Bishop Mason was alive, he would pray. And you know what he would say in his prayer? God, heal the mind. Mm-hmm. Heal the mind.
Pray for his own mind.
Yeah, pray for his own mind. Because he knew. All right? Now, we don't pray that anymore. We pray for everything else but the mind. But yet, in the church, we have more mind problems.
Exactly.
Than we do body problems. Because when the mind is sick, the body's sick.
Oh, God.
Yeah.
If
yeah.
we just go mm-hmm. back to just the simple fact that everything starts in the mind.
Yes.
Then we can be able to, you know, address and you know, get help.
Yeah.
You know?
Mind over matter. Mind over matter.
Exactly.
Yeah.
Exactly. That's where everything starts.
Well, Regina Ausley Carter.
Oh, Lord.
I wonder who that is.
She says, I need to clear understanding because she wanted to know what her husband would meant when, is he saying that all women are crazy? And I just want to know
Ooh-wee.
From her husband, are all women crazy or not? Yes.
In one way or another, yes. Because I know my wife is crazy about me.
Oh, he fixed it. He fixed it.
No, he didn't. That's not what he said in the break.
No, he didn't. Sure didn't.
Big sister, he fixed it. It's good.
Yeah. Joe Hill, 25% of all women are taking meds for mental illness, and the rest are going untreated.
Thank you, Joe.
Thank you, Joe.
Sometimes I like you, Joe, and sometimes I don't know.
See, that double-minded man that is unstable in all his ways.
Okay.
That's why they wear high heels.
Touche.
Touche. Did
you ever address what you were going to address when we came back from that break?
D does not stand for donuts, Natalie.
How do we how do we handle... The mentally
treating them socially,
yes.
How to care for them, how to treat them with respect, even though they may have challenges.
Absolutely, that's good. Notice how David treated Saul.
Mm-hmm.
Saul, who had a psychotic problem, kept trying to kill David.
Mm-hmm.
Notice David's response. He kept when he got close to Saul enough to kill him.
Mm-hmm.
The only thing he did was cut a part of his garment.
Yes,
and he says. And his cronies around says, kill him now. You're right there. He
right.
says, I cannot kill God's anointed.
Mm-hmm.
And he walked away. And then he woke Saul up from afar and says, Saul,
right.
Here's your servant. And Saul woke up and says, hey, David, is that you, baby?
Right.
He said, that's me. He says, I was this close to kill you, but I couldn't do it.
Mm-hmm.
And then Saul repented.
Mm-hmm.
Okay. And then Saul tried to kill him again. And
yes.
David keep escaping. And kept saying to Saul, I can't kill
right.
you. You God's anointed.
Right.
Yes.
And David kept waiting for that time for God to finally remove this problem from him. But David realized he couldn't be the one to remove the problem
because mm-hmm.
God did not assign him to do the garbage removal.
Okay, keep going further in that story because the very person that ended up doing it, David killed him.
David killed him. Sure did. Sit there you go.
You know,
he killed him because that's not the plan. He thought he should have died naturally at God's timing.
Preach it, sir.
Versus somebody killing him to please David.
Preach it, sir. He got the word. Go ahead,
okay,
Nick. You're trying to say something.
That's all good, but still, how are we handling these people?
Okay, well,
what I saw in that was love.
Yes, that's where I'm going.
That it's love. You have to show that love. Mm-hmm. You
agape.
Have to give that love.
Mm-hmm.
You know, because...
And one thing about crazy folk, they know if you love them or not, whether they can understand
yes.
anything else. They can
they
sense
know.
It.
Yes.
They can sense it. That's why they because come around you.
Yes.
They'll
right.
come to you.
They're attracted to
they
that
are.
Love.
That's right.
How you doing?
Mm-hmm.
Why do you always come
around me?
And then you make yourself
yes.
treat them nice.
Yes.
You would want to say, get away from me, but you don't.
Uh-huh.
Oh, so now you understand how I treat you.
Yes. That's what you do. That's right. That's right. You know? Well,
I love you,
I
big brother.
You know the
go
greatest.
Go to the bathroom is that way.
I think one of the greatest achievements of those who work out there are those teachers who work with those who are mentally challenged, those
yes.
children.
Yes.
Last year,
that is,
I asked her to address that because I had a kid in my class last year. That
sure
boy
did.
Lived to work my nerve. It seemed.
Yeah,
I did not realize it's like. From August to October, he was fine, and then something happened. He erupted, and he just became this. Turns out, as he grew up and grew older, the meds that he was taking, I never knew he was taking meds. I failed to read the file. I found out he did.
Oh.
But as he got older, the meds were not strong enough.
Mm.
Okay.
And so there had to be a chemical change in it.
Yeah.
Nevertheless, that boy would do things to me.
Mm-hmm.
Mm-hmm.
He would bother me. And I didn't realize that was actually his love language.
Wow.
Mm-hmm. Mm-hmm.
Now he's no longer in my class. The new teacher was like, how do you deal with him? He said, get Mr. Carter. He know what to do for me.
Yeah.
Well, send me back to Mr. Carter's room.
Yeah.
Right.
And I told the teacher, find out his learning style, which was kinesthetic.
Mm-hmm.
I would give him stuff to do
to
make him feel important and significant.
Mm-hmm.
Here, I had a box of papers that was organized, and I dropped it. The papers got all over the place. Robert, can you do me a favor?
Mm-hmm.
I messed up. Can you organize these papers? I'm talking over thousands of sheets of paper.
Mm-hmm. Right.
He came back. They were grouped. Took him 2 or 3 days.
Wow.
He kept busy. Now he's no longer in my class. He's passed on to the next grade. Every day he sees me, he hugs me. Mm. No one else can hug me. Mm. If another kid hugs me, he walks up and says, wipe that junk up off you. They don't love you like I do.
Wow.
And he'll come dust it off.
Wow.
See? That was it. That was
I didn't realize then I needed to love that out of him.
Yes. Uh-huh.
That's all
good.
I did was felt like a victim, but I couldn't be mean to
him. Couldn't do it.
I tried,
but
I couldn't.
And when we have people in our church who are like children, mm-hmm. even though they're in their 40s and 50s, mm-hmm. they're like children, okay? Ooh, and they're suffering from some mental illness, some type mm-hmm. of issue, okay? And we look at them and we don't want to sit in the same row with them. Mm-hmm. We don't want to talk to them after service. We just ignore them.
Right.
Okay. All right. But we need to have the compassion that Alvin had with that child.
Exactly.
Because some of them are mentally challenged where they don't know the degree of issues.
Of
where
the severity of the
issue.
They don't even know.
Right. So we have to treat them across the board.
Mm-hmm.
And Jesus had to deal with all kind of mental illness, especially with them Pharisees.
Mm-hmm.
You know, it's really strange, man. America mm-hmm. has a tendency to love the underdog.
Mm-hmm.
And the underdog is usually always the outcast.
Sure, of course.
But America loves it, but the church don't.
The church, yeah. Yes. Yeah.
I'm going to tell you why.
That's a good
point.
It just hit me.
I'm going to tell you why the church doesn't, because there's no immediate evidence of sensationalism in the treatment of those people.
Yeah, that's right.
Mm. See, they can't say, I prayed for you and you're healed.
Right.
They can't say, I laid hands on them and they recovered. Mm-hmm. It knocks the business, quote unquote, because it does not show the proficiency mm-hmm. of what they project in mm-hmm. their ministry.
Mm-hmm.
The ministry of the church is more than just miracles.
Right.
The ministry of the church is more than just worship and praise. The ministry of the church is to take care of the homeless, to take care of the invalid, to preach, to break the captive free.
Yes.
Sometimes they may be free in their ailment, but you can still give them some sense of liberty by giving them significant things to do.
Yeah.
Church don't want to do that because it takes too much time.
Too much time.
It takes too much time and commitment.
Too many Christians don't understand the collective of the human experience.
Because the pastor ain't finna do it, and he's the only one that ain't got a job.
Right. Yeah.
Sometimes. The total man needs to be ministered to.
Right.
That's a wide range. So we can't stop at, you know, just praying for them. We have to address all issues. That single mom, could be struggling. You know,
we'll change the bandage. We'll do the stitches. We'll go ahead. We will treat a physical wound as much as it need to until it heals.
Mm-hmm.
The mental issue, I done gave you a solution. Deal with it, move on.
Right.
And it's like every wound, every ailment takes time to get to that point,
mm-hmm.
and it's going to take time for it to get better as well.
Yes.
But because it's not physical, people choose to, like, you know, get impatient with it.
Mm-hmm.
Yeah, we got to get trained on this. This doesn't make any sense, y'all.
Yes.
You know, after you get a certain age, you're supposed to know better, you know, and this is why the atheists beat us every time in the scriptures, because they know it better than we,
mm-hmm.
and they win. They keep winning, and we have turned into spiritual bipolar ourselves.
Yes,
we just don't get it.
That. And then Christians don't like to utilize logic because they say that is a thing of the atheist. And I'm going like, no, actually, atheist is not using it properly.
No, they're not.
But you could use it properly if you use it dealing with spirituality.
Yeah, they're not able to use it properly because there's no such thing as atheists. Okay.
Yeah, they believe and worship something.
Yeah, they worship something. Yeah.
They
worship
in something.
Well, I'm sorry.
I need a hymn.
Atheist.
A quick hymn.
Well, I like hers.
Well,
to
each his own.
Thank you.
Well, in this discussion, we keep coming down to the one solution. That's Jesus. So, always remember Jesus. Jesus. One more time, Annette, sing this home for us.
Always remember Jesus, Jesus. Always remember Jesus, Jesus.
Always keep him on your mind.
I'm going to join it.
Always keep him on your mind.
That was beautiful. I want y'all to do y'all duet. Annette duet. That was good. That was almost that was almost perfect until Art started playing the piano. his chords was better than his voice, though, wasn't it?
Always. I know Ken song. You never. I know Ken song.
Always remember that.
No Ken song. No Ken song.
Listen, y'all, tomorrow on the Sir Walter Jones Show, it's Wednesday, Music Business Day, and we're going to construct our own stuff here. We're going to create songs on the spot. So, Facebook, what you're going to do is you're going to give us a phrase, topics, and right there on the show, we're going to start creating songs around it to show y'all how easy it is for you guys to write a song.
Yeah, like Whose Line Is It Anyway?
Yeah, Whose Line Is It? Yeah, I like that. So Sharon will be here tomorrow, and she's got a project that soon will be released, and we're trying to kind of help her get out there, and so she's going to be doing her thing and try to dissect songs for us.
Yeah, we're going to be pushing her and her
husband. Yeah, we're going to push her and her husband.
That's
right out the door.
Heaven, Lord, Jesus.
Heaven.
Leave my friends alone.
Three of them, we will.
Oh, yes. All right, so get ready tomorrow. It's going to be a crazy show. I have no idea how we're going to pull this off. Annette, tomorrow at what time?
12 o'clock until 2 o'clock.
Wow.
Yes,
wow.
Yes.
2 hours. Y'all
right here on UBM Praise.
She going to find out how hard it is to sit in this seat. Well, for 2 hours.
2 hours?
Is that encouraging?
Go ahead and no.
It's a challenge to your mind.
Yes, there you
my
go.
My body and my soul.
I don't want to touch them parts. I'm talking about your mind.
Well, that's what you should be listening to on tomorrow afternoon from 12 until 2.
Well, she got some help.
Mind, body, and soul with Annette.
All right. Okay. Yes. Hey, y'all, this is You Being Praised. Go to Spreaker. The show will be up. All right, y'all. We love y'all. This is
The Sir Walter Jones Show.
I don't know what you come to do, but I come to praise the name. Lord, Lord. Yeah, one more time. Randy Watson, how about it?
You've been listening to the Sir Walter Jones Radio Show, where he provides you with a biblical perspective for your everyday life. Stay connected to Sir Walter Jones by visiting him online at www.sirwalterjones.com or on Facebook at www.facebook.com/AskTheElder. Stay tuned until next time with the Sir Walter Jones Show with Sir Walter Jones.